In terms of the pineal and the doctors, and the psychiatrists, the pineal function is quite central to psychiatric drugs in particular, and psychiatry generally. When you talk about a third eye in Eastern philosophy, they also describe, and you can find this in a lot of New Age books, talking about intuition as being somehow tied in with pineal function.
They also talk about it as a magnetic sense organ as well.
They do, yeah. This is another area that particularly interested me, and this was in 1995, that I've been studying birds for a long time, and since I was a child I've been very interested in birds, and I'd heard somewhere, and I can't even place where, that the pineal was involved in bird senses of direction, and that the pineal was known to be a magnetic organ in birds, or thought to be a magnetic organ in birds, involved in their migratory behavior and their sense of direction. I also...
So it turns magnetic fields into neuronal hormonal messages to the body?
I don't know whether you can describe it quite like that. You can say that magnetic fields appear to affect pineal function, and pineal function involves production of hormones, or not just melatonin, it actually produces some other hormones as well. And that magnetic fields have an effect on the levels of melatonin production. Actually, magnetic fields appear to have levels effect on the levels of quite a few neurotransmitters, and that includes melatonin and serotonin and dopamine and noradrenaline, which are the four neurotransmitters that are the most focused on by psychiatry, simply because psychoactive drugs have known effects on dopamine and serotonin and noradrenaline. As to the effect of psychoactive drugs on melatonin, it's not published in the textbooks, so one doesn't really know.
Right.
Certainly, I don't know.
So,
well, I have got ideas. I mean, you can work out logically that if it has an effect on a pathway, and the pathway leads to the production of melatonin, then it's going to have an effect on melatonin as well. The very obvious concern that I'd have with people taking melatonin is that, as a general principle, if you take an exogenous hormone when your body produces the same thing, you're going to depress your own production of the hormone. So that, like, even though somebody may feel a little bit better when they're taking melatonin initially, it'll suppress your own production of melatonin. Which it's a bit like if you take cortisone. If you take cortisone, you'll actually feel euphoric. It has a euphoric effect on people. But you can imagine it's not a very good idea for people to stay on cortisone tablets for all of their life, because it causes a whole range of side effects, including immune suppression and osteoporosis and weight gain and various things. Now, I don't see how it's going to be a very good idea if your body produces melatonin to be taking exogenous melatonin for all sorts of rather mild conditions. And in fact, it may not be a good idea to take melatonin in any situation. But I was particularly interested in looking at ways that we can optimize our own neurotransmitter levels, including dopamine, noradrenaline, serotonin, melatonin, through the process of thinking in a healthy way.
Right.
So my search was really for looking at what is healthy thinking. And that is where I came into conflict with psychiatry, because they were interested in finding out what is defective thinking and who is defective. And anybody who has been labeled as thinking in an abnormal way automatically becomes defective. But as to what abnormality is based on psychiatric criteria.
Within the DSM?
Within the DSM and other psychiatric books. The DSM is an American thing, but the Europeans have got a thing called the ICD, which is the International Classification of Disease, which is very similar to, but significantly different from the DSM. And DSM is not widely accepted in Europe. Mm. There are a lot of people who criticize the style of psychiatry involved in the DSM, which is a labeling mentality, that basically they've got names for over 330 different mental abnormalities, but they haven't got treatments or they haven't got cures for any of them. In fact, they say that all these conditions are incurable. So basically, they've got a name for every style of thought and every possible abnormality. But
so your style of thought, in their eyes, is deluded.
It's deluded, yeah. My style of thought
because it challenges the foundations of psychiatry.
Yeah, it basically comes to a point of the psychiatrist or the person who's doing the diagnosing. If you disagree with them, and this happens on a general level in society anyway, people who, when they're more likely to think that somebody else is mad when they disagree with them than that they are mad. Yep. So the psychiatrists will naturally view any person who challenges the fundamental paradigm and the fundamental doctrines of psychiatry, they're likely to view that person as being mad.
Yeah, especially if it's an affront to their knowledge about a subject matter which they're supposed to be well versed in.
Yeah. Most psychiatrists won't claim to be particularly well versed in this. You know, they don't study the brain as such, not in any detail. They study human behavior, or they study psychiatry. They don't even study human behavior, really. That's a realm of psychology. So one of the things that I was criticizing is this very phenomenon, which is the division of the neurosciences into different disciplines, which all use different language, different jargon, and they don't communicate with each other. So what is common knowledge to reproductive biologists could be completely alien to psychologists. Or what is there in evolutionary biology or physiology could be completely unknown and not mentioned in textbooks and journals of a different neurosciences discipline. Now, that would be one explanation of why pineal information is there in some books and not in others. But when I researched it and looked into it in more detail, I don't believe that that's an adequate explanation.
So would you use the word conspiracy to describe the information about the pineal gland and its availability?
I'd have to say I'm wary of using the word conspiracy for the simple reason that in our society, in medical society, you could say, conspiracy is equated with paranoia. Just using the word conspiracy is automatically equated with paranoia.
It's also a legal term.
Sorry?
It's also a legal term.
A legal term.
Yeah, conspiracy.
It is.
Murder, conspiracy to overthrow the government.
Sure. Yeah, conspiracy, I mean, if you look at the legal definition as I understand it, it's two or more people plotting or conspiring in different ways, making an orchestrated plan to maybe, if you're looking at deceiving people, yeah, well, obviously, if there's information about the pineal that's known and they write in a textbook that nothing is known about the pineal, unless they actually believe that themselves, you'd have to describe it as a conspiracy.
So what do you think will happen tomorrow then at the Mental Health Review Board?
It's day after tomorrow. What will happen?
They want to put you on a community treatment order.
They already have put me on a community treatment order. That's what it's about. It's okay. To see whether or not the psychiatrist will get away with their planned treatment of me, which is to inject me with antipsychotic drugs every 2 weeks for a year, which is not a very nice experience. I have been injected with antipsychotic drugs in the past for not treatment of delusional disorder, but for a range of different labels that have been given to me. This has not been done for about 2 years, but when I have been injected with these drugs, it's made me very, very sick. But they make everyone sick, some sicker than others.
Right. So what are your chances of appealing successfully the community treatment order?